Hi everyone, welcome to our talk. We'll be talking today about how to build community alliances to promote reproductive justice principles in family medicine. My name is Chelsea Brown and I'm a third year in the Montefiore Family Medicine Residency Program, and I'm currently in our program's reproductive health track.
And my name is Payal Patel and I am the second year reproductive health fellow here at Montefiore in the Department of Family and Social Medicine. We'd like to thank Marcella Howell for being here today as our guest speaker. Marcella, would you like to tell us a little bit about yourself and your organization?
My name is Marcella Howell. I am the founder and president of In Our Own Voice, National Black Women's Reproductive Justice Agenda, which is national reproductive justice organization focused on lifting up the voices of Black women leaders at the national, regional, and state levels on policies that impact our lives. In Our Own Voice is a partnership with 8 Black women's organizations: Black Women for Wellness, Black Women's Health Imperative, New Voices for Reproductive Justice, Sister Love, Sister Reach, Spark Reproductive Justice Now, the AFIA Center, and Women with a Vision.
At the end of this session, attendees should be able to differentiate reproductive health and reproductive rights from reproductive justice, identify ways to promote patient autonomy in practice using a reproductive justice lens, and describe how collaborating with reproductive justice organizations can promote patient autonomy.
Before we get started, we would like to first acknowledge how medicine and reproductive oppression are interrelated. It is important to recognize that many of our patients experience multiple forms of social oppression and discrimination. This deems some groups of people, typically those who are white, Christian, educated, higher income, etc., as more valuable than others. And when we talk about reproductive health, this specifically deems certain groups of people to be more fit to parent than others. People of color, people with lower incomes, and younger patients often fall under the group of people who experience reproductive oppression. And this leads them to having few real choices about how and when to have and raise healthy families. So what this means is that many patients don't really have a choice when it comes to their reproductive health due to many societal influences. Accessing full reproductive choice, therefore, requires addressing many forms of inequity, including government regulations and other systemic social issues. I want to emphasize that all of our healthcare institutions also exist in the context of the U.S. history of racism and contribute to this and other forms of structural oppression.
Reproductive coercion is defined as behaviors that interfere with decision-making related to reproductive health. Many vulnerable populations in the United States have experienced reproductive coercion by medical professionals. In 1907, the Indiana Eugenics Law was passed and led to the forced sterilization of individuals in state facilities. In the 1960s, Mexican women in California were coerced to sign consent forms for sterilization and were wrongly told that the procedure could be reversed. The 1978 federal sterilization regulations prohibited coercive sterilization practices. But despite this, between 2006 and 2010, many female inmates in California were sterilized without their consent. Reproductive coercion has continued through contraceptive methods. In the 1990s, women who received public assistance were given incentives if they obtained the contraceptive implant, which was called Norplant at that time. Even today, clinicians push patients to be on birth control due to the flawed thinking that certain patients should be on birth control due to their socioeconomic status or life situation. The vulnerable populations who are disproportionately affected include those who are low income, institutionalized, have multiple children, and are people of color. Unfortunately, our biases can be difficult to recognize and make their way into medical education and patient interactions.
We'll next go into exploring what reproductive health, reproductive rights, and reproductive justice are. It's important to recognize these are all different but interrelated. Reproductive health is focused on providing direct clinical services such as STI testing and treatment, miscarriage management, contraceptive care, and abortion care. Reproductive Health focuses on training doctors, establishing clinics, and educating and providing care to individual patients. Often, these services are provided in silos, such as family planning clinics or academic medical centers. This framework does not address the root cause of inequity. Reproductive rights are the individual legal rights to reproductive health, with a focus on keeping abortion legal. It is often considered the goal of the pro-choice movement. The reproductive rights lens often focuses on the single issue of reproductive choice, and has often ignored the fact that for people of color and people without resources, there may not be the possibility for a real choice about whether to get pregnant or to have a child. The language of choice primarily resonates with those who feel they have the resources to make choices. This does not address the fact that a legal right to services does not mean that those services are accessible, equally distributed, or non-coercive.
Next, we'll share a video that introduces reproductive justice.
Reproductive justice. A lot of people talk about it, but many don't know what it really means. Here's the basic idea. Coined by 12 Black women in June of 1994, the term is the combination of two phrases, reproductive rights and social justice. The new phrase reflected the lives and experiences of Black women in the United States who had been denied a full range of services and protections. Black women have multiple identities, like age, ability, sexual orientation, immigration status, religion, and nationality, just to name a few. Consider the fact that Black women experience some of the highest rates of poverty and only make 63 cents for every dollar a white man makes. Nearly 20% of Black women have no health insurance and die four times as often as white women from pregnancy-related causes, regardless of income or educational status. The issue at play here is intersectionality, a term coined by legal scholar Kimberly Crenshaw, which refers to how multiple systems of oppression work together. Reproductive justice is how we take on all the systems that harm us. Reproductive justice is the human right that can only be achieved when all women and girls have the complete economic, social, and political power and resources to make healthy decisions about our bodies, our families, and our communities in all areas of our lives. Reproductive justice centers the leadership and lived experiences of the most vulnerable, including but not limited to Black women, women of color, LGBTQ people, and youth. So there you have it. Reproductive justice has given thousands of women a framework to change policy, improve services, collaborate with other social justice movements towards our collective liberation. For more information, contact In Our Own Voice at www.blackrj.org. Thanks for watching and welcome to the movement.
That's a really helpful video in terms of understanding the origins of RJ. Marcella, do you mind telling us a little bit more about reproductive justice?
Reproductive justice is the human right to control our bodies, our sexuality, our gender, our work, and our reproduction. And that right, we believe, can only be achieved when all women and girls have the complete economic, social, and political power and resources to make healthy decisions about our bodies, our families, and our communities in all areas of our lives.
As mentioned in the video, intersectionality was coined by Kimberly Crenshaw, a lawyer and civil rights advocate. It is a framework that describes how multiple forms of discrimination related to race, class, gender, and other characteristics overlap in the experiences of marginalized people. Marcella, we know the video touched a bit on intersectionality. Do you mind explaining to us what intersectionality means and give us an example?
Reproductive justice looks at things from a human rights perspective. And what we do is we incorporate the intersections of race, gender, class, sexual orientation, gender identity with the kind of situational impacts that we have in our lives that fall down into economics, politics, culture. So we look at housing issues, environmental justice issues, racial justice issues, issues dealing with healthcare, and of course, with the empowerment of Black women. All of those things intersect in the everyday lived experiences of Black women. And so we look at reproductive justice with that kind of a lens.
Thanks, Marcella. Another great example that comes to mind in family medicine is thinking about a patient with poorly controlled diabetes. There are many forms of oppression that can overlap in this case. Think about a patient on insulin with housing insecurity who cannot store their insulin safely in a refrigerated temperature. On top of that, hearing their doctor repeatedly stress the importance of eating fruits and vegetables, but living in a food desert or area with lack of access to fresh, affordable produce. The same patient can also be motivated to exercise, but because of zone districting, local parks are underfunded.
Medical students, physicians, and other clinicians play a really important role in promoting reproductive autonomy for our patients. Marcella, what are some ways that medical professionals can stop perpetuating reproductive coercion?
Well, that's an interesting question, because if you look at the history of medical experimentation on Black women in America, if you look at just how people developed a lot of the procedures for that are obstetric procedures, it was through a doctor who experimented on his Black female slaves without anesthetics or anything. He basically honed his craft by experimenting on them. We also have examples where Black women have been sterilized. So when white women were fighting for the right to terminate a pregnancy, Black women were fighting for the right to actually have children. We can look at various different causes in terms of medicine and experimentation, so that when any Black woman goes to public health, a doctor, a nurse, they come with that knowledge of experimentation and distrust. So for family medicine, for physicians, they're going to have to get over that hurdle first. And the way that they can do that is being completely honest with their patient, not making an assumption when they see them walk in the door about what their life may be like, and instead asking them questions about what they're there for, respecting their decisions about what they want to do with their own body, and basically being a partner in making health decisions.
And what are some ways that medical professionals can promote RJ?
If you approach the medical profession from a human rights perspective, that is acknowledging that a patient has a right to make decisions about their own body, then what you do as a physician is you give them all of their options. You don't just make an assumption about an option. For instance, if someone comes in and it's a Black woman who has four kids and they come in asking for birth control pills, most physicians these days would look at them and say, well, you already have four kids. Maybe you want an IUD or a shot of Depro. And the person will say, no, I just want birth control pills. Many times from our discussions with Black women, they find that physicians are trying to talk them out of their choice for family planning, and instead of listening to them. And so in that sense, they feel like they walk in looking for birth control pills and walk out with an IUD or a shot. That is not the way to approach a patient who understands reproductive justice and who lives from that human rights framework.
All right, we are now going to go through a few cases that we see commonly in the family medicine setting. We'll read through the cases together, walk through what we've seen in the past, and then work through how cases like this can be approached with an RJ lens and keeping patient autonomy in mind. So case one, you have just seen a patient on the postpartum floor who's being discharged today. She just delivered her sixth child via an uncomplicated vaginal delivery, and she and baby are both doing well. You bring up postpartum contraception and the patient declines.
This is a situation that many medical professionals, especially family physicians, have come across, given that we often take care of our patients and their babies after deliveries. What do you think?
There are a few things here that I think we've been trained are quote unquote red flags based on this scenario. One of the things is that this patient just delivered her sixth child. I think many physicians may be quick to deem that quote unquote too many, but often this judgment can be based on the patient's age, race, and socioeconomic status.
Yeah, this is really interesting because it kind of shows that physicians make judgments about what a normal family size is and who should or shouldn't have larger families.
Exactly. The important thing here is to make sure the patient is the one deciding these things based on their experiences, and the physician is there to support them by providing them non-judgmental prenatal care, postpartum care, etc.
Great point. It's not our job to decide how large our patients' families are. It's our job to figure out how we can support our patients the best and ultimately support their families.
Mm-hmm. Another thing that some may think is a quote-unquote red flag is that the patient declined postpartum contraception. I think most physicians feel like patients should make a birth control decision before leaving the hospital. But it's important to keep in mind that, again, we're here to support our patients in what they decide instead of making them feel like they need to be on birth control.
Yeah, this is so true. Something that I've learned is to ask permission to talk about contraception when I'm with patients to make sure they know that they can feel comfortable bringing it up, and so they also know that this is a safe place. But it also kind of puts the patient in control of the conversation and doesn't make them think I, as their physician, recommend that they be on birth control.
Yeah, that's a great point. Marcella, what are your thoughts about this case and how a patient scenario like this can be approached from an RJ lens?
It may be that they've had a bad experience with taking a pill. They've had a bad experience with an IUD. You never know what the rationale may be. And it may be just that simple that they've had a bad experience with some form of birth control. And so a physician or a nurse should talk to them about what other options they could have instead of just making an assumption that they don't care about how many children they have, about planning their family. They may want to plan their family, but they may have had a very bad experience. It may also be that they basically want to have more children.
We've also seen that assumptions can be made about patients depending on their race. Some people may look at this case differently based on if this is a white woman or a woman of color.
Yes, I think that's part of the problem that we have, is that if it's a white woman who is married, has a good job, their husband has a good job, they're a public health person is going to make certain assumptions that they can afford this. If it's a Black woman who has the exact same circumstances, married, has good job, good health care, and wants to not have any kind of contraception, the fact that it is a Black woman, that there is going to be this perception that they probably have too many children, as opposed to maybe they just want to have a large family. Maybe they came from a large family. I came from a family of seven. Do I want to have seven kids? No, but that is my decision to make. And I think that we do make assumptions about people based on their race that we should not be making.
Thanks, Marcella. I think a takeaway from this case is realizing when we have those quote red flags pop up in our head and pausing to think, where is that thought coming from or based on? And acknowledge that any recommendation to our patient based on that quote red flag can be a form of reproductive coercion.
Case two, a 15-year-old patient comes into your office after having a positive home pregnancy test. She's excited and eager to start prenatal care.
As family physicians, we see patients of all ages and also do prenatal care, which is pretty neat.
Yeah, definitely. I think we're trained to think teenage pregnancy is always a bad thing. So I think we all come in with this bias when we're approaching a patient scenario like this.
Yeah, it's really interesting and brings up a lot of the concepts we've touched on. Teenage pregnancy is referred to as a negative outcome in literature and even in a lot of the resources we use to guide our practice. But when we really think about it, is teen pregnancy the issue, or is it that the racism and sexism embedded in society limit many people from parenting in safe and healthy environments? We don't think about how our society doesn't support or allow some people to parent and to have adequate resources like healthcare, childcare, and access to food and water. Many people equate teen pregnancy to poverty and poor outcomes, but there's so much more to poverty than just a teenager who is pregnant that we don't take into consideration. And there's this idea that a parent should be finished in school, in a relationship, and financially stable. But again, these are things that may not be our patient's goals.
Yeah, and it seems like the patient is clearly here to establish prenatal care and is excited, but I can also see that some physicians may try to make the patient consider all of her options, including abortion.
Yeah, options counseling is important with some patients who were truly unsure, but it seems pretty clear that this patient knows what she wants. Bringing up an abortion may indicate to the patient that you as their physician aren't fully supportive of their pregnancy.
Marcella, what are some important things we should keep in mind when approaching this case from an RJ lens?
Well, if this teenager is excited about being pregnant, she should be, that decision about her excitement should be honored. It should not be someone should not be sitting there saying, but you know, teen pregnancy is really bad. You're not going to finish school. It's really hard for a teen mother, because she may have a support network within her community, within her family. It may be tradition within their family of younger teens becoming pregnant. She may be married. You don't know. She may have a very stable relationship. You just don't know. And so you should not make assumptions. Very often when people come into a public health setting looking to terminate a pregnancy, they have made that decision before they walk in the door. Just as if they're coming in wanting to carry a pregnancy to term, they may have made that decision before they walk in the door. And those decisions should be honored. But having them plan out what they're going to do in terms of their pregnancy and how they're going, whether they want to have a birth at home or a birth in a hospital, what kind of setting, all of those kind of discussions will reveal what that person thinks and why she might be excited, where you as a public health professional may not be excited because she's a teenager.
Something important to keep in mind is that many physicians have been trained in a biased medical system. And many of us as physicians have never and will never have the lived experiences of our patients. In order to move forward, family physicians must first acknowledge that they lack the experiences of many individuals who are better represented by organizations at the forefront of the reproductive justice movement. Collaborating with these organizations and building community alliances will allow us to start these conversations with each other and our learners to ultimately provide better patient care. Marcella, can you tell us a little bit about what collaborating with RJ organizations can look like for physicians and how we can ultimately help our patients by doing so?
A lot of RJ organizations work with doulas and midwives, and people are very comfortable with doulas, helping them through their pregnancy, figuring out what their plan is, because doulas will help you make a plan. Some of them are also not comfortable with having a birth within a hospital, and they might want to be in a birthing center, or they might want to have their child at home. So there are all these different kind of pieces that go into it. And RJ organizations can help physicians to really think through how they approach patients. understanding what how to talk to them about their decision making is really important. And I think that's how that's where RJ organizations, especially those that work in a community setting, can be very helpful.
Are there resources that we could use?
Usually, talking to people in the community, looking up things online, Googling reproductive justice organizations and finding out who's in your community. There are actually a number of women's clinics who are RJ clinics that can also be helpful. And there are a number of reproductive justice organizations that you can find by checking in with us at In Our Own Voice. We work with a number of RJ organizations across the country.
Marcella, is there anything else you would like to add that medical professionals can take away when approaching patient care and talking to patients in a way that promotes patient autonomy?
I think the first thing that anyone in the medical profession has to really acknowledge is that each patient has a right to make their own decisions about their body. And that if you approach your patients that from that perspective, that you may not know what's best for that patient. You don't know what their lived experiences are. And that you acknowledge that they have the right to make those decisions, you're going to talk to them in a way that presents them with their different options, and then talk them through what those options mean and help them make their own decision about what they want to do. And I think that that's the way to approach any patient, using that RJ perspective and really thinking about the right to make these kind of decisions and the right to have control over your own body, and therefore seeing it as a human rights framework as opposed to physicians know all and therefore just dictate what you should be doing.
And how can folks learn more about your organization?
Well, they can go to our website, which is www.blackrj.org, and learn a great deal about us and read about things. And you can be in contact with us at info@blackrj.org, or you can actually be in touch with me at marcella@blackrj.org.
Thank you so much, Marcella. We really appreciate you taking time to help inform us about reproductive justice and how physicians can work with RJ organizations to ensure that our patients are receiving the best care possible. As we close this presentation, it's important that we all take a moment to think about what we've talked about and what next steps we can take. Think about how this system of placing value on parenthood for different people impacts the way we provide care to our patients, teach our learners, and work within the existing healthcare system. How do you see collaborating with an RJ organization as helpful to you in terms of patient care? And how can you see bringing this to where you work? This can involve inviting speakers for grand rounds, using resources provided today, and allowing coworkers and learners to take extra time when thinking about patient care. Thank you to Racine Tucker-Hamilton, Tara Stein, Ian LeGue, Allison Paul, and Zoe Thill for helping us make this presentation possible.